Hey, screenwriters and storytellers, you're tuned in to the Write On podcast from Final Draft. I'm Shani Edwards. On today's episode, I speak to Poor Things screenwriter Tony McNamara about his second collaboration with director Yorgos Lanthimos after 2018's The Favorite. Poor Things stars Emma Stone and Willem Dafoe with a genius performance from Mark Ruffalo. This movie is part Frankenstein story, part fairy tale, and part coming-of-age story full of sexual liberation. I chat with Tony about his ability to create fascinating female characters, writing sex scenes, and the ways this film is similar to this year's blockbuster Barbie. Yeah. Poor Things is my personal favorite film of the year, so let's start the show. Hi, Tony. Welcome back to the podcast. I'm so crazy excited to talk to you about Poor Things.
Well, thank you. It's very great to be here. Great to talk about it.
Oh, last time you and I chatted, it was about the third season of The Great, which I also loved.
Thank you.
I'm guessing that has completed. Is that correct?
Yeah. That was the last season.
And so, okay. So that's done, but
that is gone.
Okay, well, that's all right. It was fantastic. And for my listeners, if you haven't seen The Great, there's three amazing seasons of it on Hulu, and if you love historical drama, you're going to love this because it is so inventive and imaginative and fun. But let's get into Poor Things. This movie does a lot of different things. On one hand, it's like a Frankenstein story. It's a coming of age story. It's a fairy tale. It's a satire on men. When you read the book, what kind of movie did you think you were going to write?
I think when I first read the book, the book's kind of encompasses a lot of things, and it's probably not that funny, but I knew, you know, Yorgos and I have a similar sense of humor, so I knew it would be comedic. And I think it was that. I think what you said, I was like, this is kind of a great Frankenstein premise to wrap a story about a young woman sort of entering the world sort of completely naive, and also be a satire about the intrinsic need, seeming need for human beings and men, particularly maybe of women, like to control. And so it was about a woman trying to just have this adventure and sort of self-create herself while everyone around her is trying to sort of control what that creation is. So it seemed like a really challenging adapt. I'd never adapted a book before. It was kind of massive. It's full of Scottish nationalism and politics and philosophy. And so I was trying to like, and also the biggest thing about it, I guess, in an adaptation sense was the book is that her story is never told from her point of view. It's all told from the men's point of view. And so that was sort of one of the things I was really, you know, and Yorgos wanted to do. And as soon as I read it, I wanted to do it too, was put her at the center of the film and have her experience be the thing we watched.
Well, I really appreciate that. There have been a few movies lately, and as much as I really liked Flowers of the Killer Moon, or Killers of the Flower Moon, I really wish that they had told it from the young lady's perspective, because I felt like her voice was missing in a lot of that story. But anyways, that's a whole other tangent to go down. I really appreciated the creativity and just the irreverence of Poor Things in the steampunk world that was created, and that sense of a fairy tale. Let's talk about the character of Bella Baxter. And did you have to kind of put your own shape into her to tell the story from her point of view, or how close did you keep it?
I had some events, I guess, because Duncan wrote letters about her and got, you know, there was kind of reportage about her experience, but nothing from her point of view. And there was a lot of gaps, you know, there was a lot of like, she's in Lisbon, but you knew a little bit about what she did, but you didn't know a lot. And the same with the ship, and the same with, so there was kind of creating the journey of it and picking and choosing what aspects you would tell, like how I would tell the evolution of this person. And through knowing that it was like a physical journey as well as an internal journey, and how to marry those two together so that you were kind of watching that evolution the whole time. And then I guess the good thing was the book was great and had, you know, some incredibly great ideas in it. And then, but it also, because it didn't really go from her perspective, it gave a lot of freedom. And also it was a big challenge because then it was like, what does she do when she's out in the world? Because a lot of that was reported. And even in the third act, you know, she never goes to Blessington's house. That was something I invented a few drafts in because we weren't completely happy with the third act we'd chosen, which was more off the book, I guess. Even though some aspects of the third act were like that, I was, you know, by the time you write the movie, you're in the character. And I was like, I think she would choose to go find out what happened, you know?
Yeah, that was really chilling to see her go to the man that she was once married to and tried to kill herself because of her unhappiness about her life with him.
Yeah.
It's almost like this a story in reverse in a way, because we start in the beginning where she's basically brain dead but pregnant, and they put the brain of the fetus into her, and then she has to kind of start over. And it's such a beautiful metaphor for feminism, you know, and for men's relationship to women. How did you see her in terms of modern day women? We've had a lot of, well, there's another film about feminine identity, and we'll get into that came out this year. Right. And how did you see her as a modern day heroine?
I really didn't think about her as a modern day heroine. What I did think about was how to create a language in the dialogue and the world, but really through the dialogue and action that made her accessible to a contemporary audience, made her and I guess because I don't know any women from 1895, so
you don't.
I guess my only models are people I know now, you know. So, but also it was about how to create a language that would be period and contemporary enough that you felt like she was a contemporary, you could relate to her as a contemporary woman. And so there was a lot of work in that, creating that language in itself, but then also creating her specific way of speaking and the evolution of that language throughout as she kind of went through each experience of, you know, be it sort of sexual or intellectual or physical or political or, you know, all of that her language had to continually change. And it also had to also be a language and things we understood, you know, stuff we understood or stuff that were related to us, you know, experiences that weren't our thing. Cause obviously it's a sort of imagined fantasy world on a lot of levels, but enough that you could relate to it.
Got it. She is constantly told by some of the men in her life, not her father or Godwin, the guy who created her modern or herself as we get to know Bella. She takes lovers and they like to tell her, you know, you're not adhering to polite society of the Victorian era. And I'm wondering if the Victorian era and polite society was kind of a character in this story for you. How did you think of all of that?
I think I was just always trying to, I think it was a sort of protagonist antagonist situation where she was trying to like just have an adventure her way through life and have experiences, and she didn't have any shame about any of it because nothing had, she was just being led by her curiosity and her instincts. And you know, Victorian society, I guess, was very buttoned down. So it was a good antagonist to kind of put some of that stuff in the way, particularly when Duncan turned up. Because he was more representative of that than, say, Godwin or Max. And then, so I think I did kind of know that this idea that society had rules that is introduced to every child and would be introduced to her would be a thing she was constantly sort of almost not rebellious about, just like, well, who made that up kind of thing, you know? Like stuff she kind of was like, I don't get it, you know? Because she had there was no incremental learning like a kid, you know? It was all very like, because she was transitioning through this period of childhood to teenagehood to young adulthood to adulthood very quickly.
Yes. Now, you mentioned that she had no shame. She's on this journey of self-discovery and sexual liberation, really. And I love the term furious jumping.
Yeah.
Is that something you coined?
Yeah.
It was just great.
Yeah, no, I was trying to I can't remember why I coined it, but I wanted her to have a particular way of speaking that kind of was her own, that kind of she didn't, the names for things, in the same way the names we call things, we call them that because someone told us that's what they're called, but we can have our own, you know, in the way she just had a response to how she felt in that experience and added the words to that experience to kind of give herself a literal experience of that. So it seemed like that would be part of her character, that she would just respond to sort of external experiences, but also just rather than go, what's that called? She would have her own take on everything.
Oh, I loved it. I want to ask you about the relationship with Godwin Baxter, who's played so remarkably by Willem Dafoe. I mean, I can't imagine anybody else in that role.
No. Yeah, it's beautiful.
He's beautiful. And we talked about this being a Frankenstein story, but it's almost an inverted Frankenstein story because he looks more like the monster in Frankenstein.
Yeah.
And she's more put together and beautiful the way Dr. Frankenstein perhaps was. Godwin was raised in a very strange home.
Yeah.
But I love that he thought of her as a daughter. Tell me about their relationship and how you understood that relationship and their connection.
Yeah, I think we wanted it to be basically it was a complicated thing. It was like it was going to be a father-daughter relationship ostensibly, but also a scientist and his experiment relationship on one level. And also, I think, you know, Yorgos was interested in the idea that people would think it was something creepier than that, but it wasn't going to be that. You know, it was actually he did love her, and he was coming himself. Like, we added this, I think in the book he has a father who, you know, is a sort of imperious figure in his life, but I added all the experiments that his father did on him and all the various explanations for the trauma and stuff, because you know, he was a guy who had all this trauma, and it manifested in a kind of this desire for love and so desire to be seen. And so the idea was those elements would help give us that. And yeah, I think he's just a really interesting character, and their relationship was never going to be, it manifested in an ugly way as well as a beautiful way. And that's part of her journey, was that she recognizes both of those things, and one didn't cancel the other out. Her love for him stood, but she was also very clear about how she felt about what he'd done, you know. So yeah, it seemed like a really kind of interesting relationship, and in a way relatable from a simple, like, in when I thought about it, I thought it's a simple, if you know, in screenwriting terms, I try to simplify everything to something very basic. And it was as simple as a father who sort of loves a child too much and protects them too much, creates, makes them, wants them to be something too much, all those things that are relatable. And it's a kind of, you know, love slightly gone wrong, but that at its base, it is love, you know.
Absolutely. And like a father, she calls him God, and he is her creator in every sense. In a lot of senses, I guess. And at some point, you know, it's symbolic of, you know, having a psychological maturity, and you have to leave God and kind of go and see what life is like without God. And I loved that aspect to it. You mentioned Duncan Wedderburn, played so great by Mark Ruffalo. I would never have thought to cast him, but I'm so happy that you did. He tickles watching him.
He's amazing. Yeah, he's so funny. I know Yorgos as well. Like, I know we didn't think it was going to be as wild and as funny as he just brought so much to it. And yeah, he's incredible.
It's funny because his character is not necessarily a bad guy. He's just a guy of his time period. Yeah. And he's really smitten with Bella. But then she begins to basically unwind him, right?
Yep.
Maybe it. maybe you can talk about how the arc of that relationship goes from being him being in control to her seizing control. It's beautiful to watch.
I think because he was such, like, in a way, as a character, it was starting with a character who was kind of a trope and of the cad. But he was always, even at the start when he first meets Bella, he's a cad who believes in freedom and liberty and all the things she's interested in. But also he's a guy who's been very used to playing the cad and people fall in love with him. And so it was just interesting that because she doesn't know her role in that relationship, she's not playing a role. She's not fitting anything he thinks. And he's kind of providing his own narrative about her early on. About what he, you know, it's a young woman and he's going to have her and kind of throw her aside. But I think what was delicious about the storytelling of it was to see a man like that also suddenly get insight. Like, he has a moment of insight where he's like, I've become the thing I sort of loathe, which is needy. And, you know, and so it just seemed fun to literally pull a character like that apart. And still not make him like I. And that's the beauty of having Mark, and he's sort of awful, but you know where it's coming from. And I think as a screenwriter, that's the biggest thing for me. It's always people can behave awfully, and I think if you know why and where it comes from, and there's some very human aspect to that need, like that he has, that he does love her, that he didn't know he could feel that way, and also that he feels like he should be able to possess her, but she completely unravels him all the time. It felt like a great arc, and it felt like it was really fun to write. And we cut out, I remember the last edit of the script Yorgos and I did, we found it really hard because we had to throw out some really funny scenes, and because he was just the gift that kept giving.
Yeah.
That was Duncan. He really was the key to in a lot of ways, the key to the story and the catalyst to the story as well, in a sort of structural way. He was the reflection of how her evolution was happening. You know, he got her out of there, and then she found a freedom, and then he tried to stop that, and then she found an intellectual freedom and he tried to stop that. And, you know, it was this kind of cool thing that he kept coming back, and that he was the catalyst for bringing her husband back. And
yeah, what a great, remarkable way to tell a satire on the male-female dynamic that I really related to that relationship. And I didn't live in 1895. So I don't know what says about me, but I think a lot of women will understand that need for control and then manipulation on both sides, you know.
Yeah, totally.
Mentioned that there's another film about feminine identity. And of course, they're calling it the biggest movie of all time, which is Barbie. I don't know if you've seen the Barbie film.
I have seen the Barbie film.
Yeah. It's in some ways, these movies have similarities. They're obviously very, very different. But they're both these movies Barbie is a doll, and we project all of our fantasies and desires onto her. And when the character Bella starts, she's sort of this empty vessel, and she has to kind of grow and become whoever she's going to become. And the biggest difference for me, I think, was that Barbie, being an American creation, has shame, a lot of shame. No sex, whereas Bella has lots of sex and no shame. And I wonder if it ever occurred to you that you would be compared to this children's or teenager's doll movie.
No, I didn't think we would. I mean, I'm a big fan of all those, you know, Margot and Noah and Greta. I think, you know, such a funny movie. Yeah, I didn't think we'd be compared. And it is funny how movies come out like that, because it takes so long to make a movie. You know, we started this 7 years ago, and then things come out at the same time and they've got similar thoughts or similar ideas. And it's always very interesting to me how that happens.
Yeah, this definitely, I know you're Australian, but Yorgos is Greek. So to me, this is guilty. Yeah.
I said guilty as charged.
Poor Things has a very European feel and vibe, and, you know, all the sex and in the film, and there's, you know, and that's great. I love that. And Americans, I think, could use a little more of that perspective.
Yeah, I think there's something in, there was always going to be, there was a European feeling about it. And I think when I read the book and there was something in Talk to Yorgos, there was something in it that felt like a Fellini movie and movies from that era of the late 60s, early 70s, those big European movies that were sort of surreal and that was sort of, you know, they just took stuff on. It seemed like, you know, and Yorgos had a vision for a very big world of that, and the film was always going to be a part fantasy. And so, you know, I think it is, you know, in some ways, I think we thought about it as a European film in the approach to it rather. And I think maybe that did free us a bit from a more sort of Western Australian even and American, because we're very similar aesthetic view of it that might've. So yeah, I think for me, I thought a lot about Fellini and obviously Young Frankenstein,
yes.
But that was kind of where it was coming from. So I think that did feel like we were free to do something.
Earlier, I mentioned this being a type of fairy tale. Did you see it as kind of a fairy tale as well? And are there rules and freedom in telling fairy tales that you adhered to?
Yeah, I don't think I thought of it as a fairy tale, but I knew it was a fantasy. I mean, I think you always kept using that word to me. But I think as a writer, yes, it's a fantasy, but it was always grounded for me. And then it was about any world that's not like a straight contemporary or a straight up naturalism. It had to have rules. So there were rules about her, and there were rules about, you know, I think that's, you know, even the Victorian society thing and how much of the world we would show, and, you know, how, you know, and I guess that was the thing. It's like, there were rules about how any character operates. I guess you kind of have rules around what they believe and what they are trying to do. And I think it was trying to keep, you know, I think there was a lot of choices in the world. Like, it was quite a journey to create the journey, because we had a lot of choices about how to do that and when things should happen within each. Like, each thing had rules around the boat and Alexandria. And so there were, like, a lot of thinking about that, I guess.
What about the scenes, the period in the film where she's at the brothel? Madame Swiney is just such a delicious character. Loved her cover in Tattoos and biting the earlobes. And
yeah.
Maybe you could tell me a little about that world and if there were rules that you wanted to follow in that era of the film.
There wasn't a huge amount of, like, from the book, maybe there was a little bit that she went there. And I think it wasn't so much rules. I think we were just, it was an approach about, you know, it was another level of, like, because essentially it's a coming of age movie. So that section of it was her going into this experience, sort of her experience at stake on one level, and where she felt she would walk into. And then I think for us, it was then like how we would, what was she, you know, it was all like, and I think that's the sex scene thing. It's like, I think last night someone's asked about how I write sex scenes, and I was like, I don't. I write character scenes, and they're sometimes having sex during that character scene. Like, it's a beat about character, and it's a beat about the experience of life, you know, the experience of what she's learning. And at first it's like, it's interesting to her, then it becomes more horrific, then she slowly realizes, you know, this Catherine Hunter, who plays Swiney, is not a friend to her and a mentor, you know, for a minute. You know, there was sort of always an evolution in the sense that Catherine started as seemingly a friend, then a philosophical mentor, which is what she was looking for. And then she kind of decoupled from the philosophical mentor because the actual physical experience was becoming gross to her. And sex was also very important to her, and she wanted to save that part of herself. So I think through the brothel, and also within the brothel, I really wanted the idea of that she didn't lose her ability. Like, the best thing about her character was, like, she's resilient and she believes, as Godwin taught her or whatever, that you can always improve the world. And so her idea was, you know, even her idea of, like, I don't know about men choosing the hooker. I should choose the man so it's not gross and he feels better. That, you know, even things like that, that there was this continual idea that, and I think that's what Emma really loved, the lack of shame around that, but also the resilience and the kind of optimism. And, you know, I had this thing about her where I was like, she has this optimism about the adventure of life, and she'll continually come back. You know, she continually steps up to that. And that seemed like a really good character trait. And, you know, and in the brothel, I felt, you know, that was really the high point of that. It was where she kind of comes together on philosophy and comes together on needing to be back with her family and comes together on being a dog. You know, there was all these aspects of her that were coming together. So it was a really important section of the film to kind of end the traveling journey and go home.
Yeah, it was unexpected on my part, but so interesting to see those lessons that you mentioned about this mentor and then that relationship turning sexual and her needing to get out of it. There's when they're on the ship, there is a dance scene that just delighted me. Was that something that you wrote into the script?
Yeah, the dance scene's in the script. And I mean, you know, but then Yorgos has a choreographer and who works on all these movies, and she came in and worked with Mar. And the room was amazing. It was this massive room in Budapest. And yeah, I mean, it's, you can write it, you know, it is a good scene on the page, but it's extraordinary on screen because they just bring so much to it. And there's such a wildness to it and the way Yorgos films it. So it's one of those scenes where you write three lines on a page, you know. I mean, the whole scene is a couple of pages, but it was an important scene for them as a relationship, but then the way they did it, so amazing.
I'm sure we're going to be seeing people recreate that dance scene on TikTok. I can't wait. I just think everybody's going to want to try and figure out those moves and get through it. It's so startling and surprising. How was this story, this movie, how was it personal to you?
You know, I think it was personal to, I don't look for that. I think it was personal to me in a lot of ways, in the sense that, like, in a dumb way, I was a young kid who lived in the country in a town where I didn't know much about anything. So I knew what it was like to go from a very small world. And I remember I think one thing I did remember was when I first went to the city as an 18-year-old to work. I remember the shock of it. It was sort of overwhelming to me and quite exciting, but also I remember this learning curve of what the world was actually like, because I'd grown up in a small country town and I just lived on a property with my brother, three brothers and three cousins. And so I was and I had a bit of that. So I had a bit of that, what, the world's like this and people are saying it's like this, and how am I going to respond to that, and what's that going to turn me into? So I did like the idea of a character trying to work out how to go through the world, and you can't avoid that the world hammers you into some shapes, but you can, you know, a character who can sort of almost skate through all that, and almost like doesn't get sort of hammered here and there, but keeps going. And part of the hammering is part of the self-creation that she embraces, you know. So I think I related to that. And then I kind of course, relate, you know, I'm a man writing a woman's story. And so it was a great satire around, you know, it was to be able to show these various aspects of male psyche and the way, you know, to the tragic comic way men make bad decisions from love or from desire or from, and try to control. You know, and even though I wanted it to not just be men trying to control it, but that was a big part of the movie. And obviously Swiney tries as well, and Martha in her way philosophically. But yeah, I found out those things, being a man and like a female experience of men, and like this weird thing of you see ugly things of men trying to control women that you're kind of like, why? So I think all of those things, I guess, in a very long answer that was possibly not articulate about my personal relationship with this story.
I love it. You know, it's funny because people, when I ask that question of writers, they often come up with something very unusual that I completely didn't expect. And the fact that you grew up on a farm with three brothers, it was a big surprise to me, because you write female characters so good. I mean, in my opinion, you are the Tennessee Williams of writing female characters. It's amazing to me.
Well, that's lovely. Thank you.
Is there something that you keep in mind when you're writing these female characters? I know, like in The Favorite and in The Great, you have these heroines that do so much and break out of the norms of society. Do you just come at it from a universal? It doesn't matter if it's male or female, or how do you come at it with these characters?
Female, I think,
characters?
I mostly come out of it. I think as a writer, I'm really like devoted to my craft. So I do come at it firstly, like I'm always in the, like, what are they in basics? I mean, like, what do they want and why and what's driving them? And that's a universal character thing for me. It's like, that's how I begin approaching a character. What are the basic drives of this person? And then I guess the male femaleness of it is, it informs it as I go, but obviously it's there and I think about it a little bit, but I certainly don't, I'm not consciously thinking about writing women characters any differently than male characters. Yeah. I kind of approach everyone the same. And then I guess I subconsciously know, you know, obviously I'm married and I have a lot of, you know, female friends and writers. And so, yeah, I don't know. The short answer is it's mostly universal. Yeah. I kind of just go from, what does the character want? What are they trying to get? And the basic want can be, because, you know, something that's, I guess, female driven, but yeah.
When you're working with Yorgos, I don't really know very much about him other than seeing his films and seeing the films that you guys did together. Who's more twisted, you or him? I mean, the lobster is pretty crazy.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy. Yeah, that's true. Sacred deer.
Yeah.
I mean, we're pretty similar. Maybe he's dark. He's probably slightly darker than me in his view of the world. But yeah, I think that's why we get on well and we work together well, because there's a lot of similarities about what we like and what we think's funny. And then there's a gap where there's a difference between us. So yeah, but I think maybe he's slightly more twisted than me. That's what I'm going to say.
I would say that I agree with you, not knowing him, but... What advice do you have for writers who want to tackle these feminine characters, these women who kind of blow our minds? Like, what would you recommend that people do, men and women writers who want to tell a story about women and make it something unusual and interesting and fresh?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what my advice would be. I mean, I think it's always the simplest things. And I think maybe my advice is, don't try and do that. Don't try and write that great female character or that great male character. Just write the character, write the truth, enjoy writing. And the invention thing comes from how you tell, you know, you need to invent because you've chosen or you've built a character that's complicated. So I don't know. I think I'd say don't. I think all my characters have one thing in common, is they're not good or bad. They're both, and the both travels with them all the time. So I think that's the only thing for me. I don't think I ever judge my characters as anything. I just tell their story.
I love that answer. Thank you.
Good, because as I ended it, I thought, I reckon that's probably bad advice.
No. I totally get it. You're saying any character should have good and bad qualities, and it's the contradictions between those two things that make them interesting and compelling. That's what I think, right? That
I think that's true. Yeah, no, it's true. I mean, you meet people like, and that's what they're like, and then you meet characters, you want them to reflect that, and then it's interesting.
Having done a lot of TV and film, which do you prefer? I know you're a playwright too, so we can throw that in the mix, but which do you prefer?
Sort of depends. When I'm in the middle of running a show, I prefer to be doing a movie, because then I'd just be home eating sandwiches and writing instead of doing a 14-hour day. But
excellent answer.
I enjoy both enormously, because, and I think I'm lucky, because I spent a lot of the early part of my career boring my wife with the conversation of, I should choose one. I should just do one. And she kept going, I think you're doing all right doing both. But so now I'm glad, because when I make a show, it's sort of very much my thing, and I have a room and I kind of enjoy that process to some degree till I get exhausted. But what I love is then just going off and writing a movie with the director, because that on a show, in a TV show, it's me and I know, you know, in the writer's room and me, and we make it as good as we can with the actors. And, but they're such massive machines. And what I love about film is it's slower, you know, and you have a bit more time with everything. You take a few months to write a draft and then you have a break and you take a few months more. But also it's about having a director who asks you as a writer, come up with more, you know. So, and, you know, I get a book that I would never have picked this book, you know what I mean? I probably wouldn't have found the book. So I get this opportunity to write something I was never going to be able to write. And an opportunity to write something is incredibly challenging to me, to kind of make me go, you know, can I do this? Am I a good enough writer to do this? And that's exciting to me, because then I've got a director who interprets it in a way where that's thrilling to suddenly be in the world of a great filmmaker and, you know, all the you know, these amazing heads of department. And so for me, I love both, and I love the fact I'm very grateful that I get to do both and that I have that career where I go back and forth. So when I tired of one, I can go do the other. So yeah, so you know, that's so there's no preference. I mean, I like them both, and some days I prefer one to the other, but overall I'm pretty happy I get to do both.
Do you think of Yorgos as your soulmate creatively?
I don't know. I mean, he's my soulmate in a sort of having lunch way, because we have a lot of, we're both obsessed with food. But yeah, I mean, I do think we're a really great creative partnership, and we have a very simple relationship. And I think that's one of the keys, and a very, yeah, he's probably, you know, he's certainly, if he's not the soulmate, he's certainly one of them.
What's next for you? Will you do another collaboration with Yorgos? Are you going to do another TV show? Tell me.
Yeah, I'm doing another. I've been writing a script for Yorgos, a new script for a couple of years. I am sitting in my computer right now, and I promised it to him tomorrow, so we'll see how that goes. But yeah, I'm doing another one with him, and I have a contemporary comedy movie that I think shoots next year, and then I'm hoping to do a limited on TV in a year or two.
Can you give me any more details?
The limited is it's a sort of marriage comedy. Basically contemporary marriage comedy. And so that'll be fun.
Well, you're getting a lot of Oscar buzz, and the film Poor Things hasn't even been released yet. So I wish you the best of luck going into award season. And I hope that you enjoy the premiere. Are you in LA for the premiere? Is that why you're here?
No, it's for screenings. There's a lot of Q&As and screenings in the week, and Santa Barbara tomorrow, and then the premiere in a couple of weeks.
Wonderful. Well, I hope you'll come back and talk to me about
next
show and movie. And I just love this. And if my listeners love The Favorite, if they love The Great, you're going to love this show. It's going to shock you. It's going to make you laugh. It's going to, the costumes alone are worth going to see.
Yeah.
The music, the dancing. I mean, this movie has everything, right?
Yeah. I mean, the design on this movie is insane. It's so extraordinary. And Jürgen's movie, I mean, I did come back from shooting when we were in Budapest and said to my wife, everyone's taking a swing. It's like everyone is going like we're all at our limit of what you think you can do. So.
I recently rewatched Cruella, which I thought design-wise was pretty spectacular, but this one is even better. So, thank you so much for joining me today. And
pleasure.
Let's talk again next time. Take care.
All right. Thank you very much.
All right. Bye, Tony.
Bye.
Thanks for listening to this episode of Right On. You can catch Poor Things in theaters starting December 8th. Thanks to you, our listeners, for making this show possible. If you like this episode and want to hear more from film and TV's best creators, leave us a review. If you haven't already, you can subscribe to our show on Apple, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. For news about new episodes and more, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter at Final Draft Inc., or on Instagram at Final Draft Screenwriting. This podcast is produced by Final Draft and Shaney Edwards. Editing is by the amazing Sean Bonnet. The music by T. Kelly. Until next time, right on.